Hello viewers, today we shall discuss monocular elevation deficiency. Monocular elevation deficiency is a limitation of elevation of the affected eye from any position of gaze. It was earlier termed double elevator palsy, a term coined by Dunlap, as it was believed to be due to a paralysis of both elevators of the eye, that is the superior rectus and inferior oblique. Other causes have been described, and hence this term has been replaced by the term monocular elevation deficiency. Pathogenesis: in some of the cases, the defective elevation can be explained by the presence of a superior rectus palsy alone. In others, a primary inferior rectus restriction, secondary contracture of the inferior rectus due to chronic hypotropia, either from superior rectus weakness or a supranuclear lesion. In some others, a supranuclear lesion is responsible. Different studies have shown a mean age at presentation of the congenital variety at about 11 to 14 years with no gender or obvious sight preference. The congenital variety of monocular elevation deficiency is of three types based on the primary cause. Type 1 is due to primary inferior rectus restriction or fibrosis. Type 2 is due to primary superior rectus palsy. And type 3 is supranuclear in origin. Acquired cases are usually caused by trauma, cerebrovascular diseases like hypertension, thromboembolism, sarcoidosis, tertiary syphilis, or tumors such as pineocytomas, acoustic neuromas, and metastasis. The patient may present with any of the following: inability to elevate the affected eye, ptosis, abnormal head posture, vertical misalignment of the eyes, diplopia, or a diminished vision due to amblyopia. Coming to the signs, the position of the globe in the primary position depends on which eye is fixing. Most commonly, the normal eye is fixing, so the affected eye is hypotropic due to deficient elevation. However, sometimes the affected eye is used for fixation, either due to or without amblyopia in the normal eye, in which case the normal eye is found to be hypertropic. There is a monocular limitation of elevation in all the three horizontal positions, that is abduction, straight ahead, and adduction. So here we see hypotropia due to elevation deficiency in the primary position, dextroversion, levoversion, upgaze, dextro elevation, levo elevation, downgaze, dextro depression, and levo depression. This picture shows a person with an acquired right monocular elevation deficiency. Note, in primary gaze, the affected right eye is used for fixation, causing a hypertropia of the normal left eye. Ptosis is absent. Ptosis or pseudoptosis. Now, whenever there is a hypotropia, there is a drooping of the upper eyelid due to facial attachments between the levator and superior rectus muscle. This is a pseudoptosis, and the way to differentiate from a true ptosis is to occlude the normal eye so the affected eye takes up fixation. The drooping disappears. Let's see this case. There is a drooping. On occlusion of the normal eye, there is an elevation, but not fully. This remaining component is that of true ptosis, which is present in this patient in addition to pseudoptosis. True ptosis may be present in about a quarter of cases, and Marcus-Gunn jaw-winking ptosis has also been reported in patients with monocular elevation deficiency. Bell's phenomenon is absent in type 1 and type 2, but present in the supranuclear etiologies. An abnormal head posture is present, if present, is in the form of chin elevation and indicates binocular fusion or fixation with the affected eye as seen in this picture. Abnormal head posture is absent if there is orthotropia in primary gaze or if the affected eye is amblyopic. Amblyopia is common in the congenital variety, and so diplopia is not common. However, bothersome vertical diplopia is common in the acquired variety of monocular elevation deficiency. Amblyopia may be present if there is a constant deviation of the affected eye, associated ptosis, or anisometropia. Upward saccades are normal from below midline to midline in cases of supranuclear and isolated inferior rectus restriction. They are reduced if there is superior rectus paresis. The various types of monocular elevation deficiency can usually be differentiated by clinical examination alone. with regard to ocular position, primary superior rectus palsy and secondary inferior rectus contracture will have hypotropia in primary gaze, whereas primary inferior rectus restriction and supranuclear may have either ortho or hypotropia. Primary superior rectus palsy and secondary inferior rectus contracture will have pseudotosis because of hypotropia. In addition, some may have true ptosis as well, whereas persons with primary inferior rectus restriction and supranuclear causes will have pseudotosis if there is hypotropia. Bell's phenomenon is present in the supranuclear monocular reservation deficiency. Upward saccades are normal in inferior rectus restriction till they are stopped by the tight inferior rectus. They are slow in the others. The force duction test is strongly positive in primary inferior rectus restriction and only weakly to moderately positive in secondary inferior rectus restriction. In inferior rectus restriction, there is a prominent lower eyelid crease that is accentuated while looking upwards, and this is greater in primary than in secondary inferior rectus restriction. So here you can see the exaggerated lid crease on the side of inferior rectus restriction. We shall first discuss the differential diagnosis of congenital monocular reservation deficiency. So let's compare a right Brown syndrome with a right monocular reservation deficiency. In Brown syndrome, there is a greater limitation of elevation in adduction than in abduction. Whereas in a monocular reservation deficiency, it is present in adduction, straight up, as well as in abduction. Also, in Brown syndrome, a Y pattern strabismus and a superior oblique restriction are seen on force duction testing. Duane syndrome can in rare circumstances have a limitation of elevation that might be confused with monocular elevation deficiency. However, other signs of Duane syndrome should be evident. Third nerve palsy may simulate the findings of monocular elevation deficiency. Abnormal pupillary reactions and exotropia of the affected eye are seen. A palsy of the superior division alone of the third nerve affecting the superior rectus and levator muscle is of course very difficult to distinguish from monocular reservation deficiency. Craniofacial syndromes may have agenesis or attenuation of the superior rectus, but in those cases the presence of the craniofacial syndrome should be obvious. This is a patient with Apert syndrome. There is a hypotropia in primary gaze. Note the absence of elevation of the left eye in abduction, which is the field of action of the superior rectus. The total agenesis of the superior rectus muscle in this patient was noted during surgery. Congenital fibrosis of the extraocular muscles affects inferior recti initially and can be confused with monocular reservation deficiency. Bilateral presentation and involvement of other extraocular muscles helps in the distinction. Many conditions can simulate an acquired monocular elevation deficiency. These may be either acquired causes of inferior rectus restriction or acquired causes of superior rectus weakness. Inferior rectus restriction may be seen in the following: orbital floor fracture with inferior rectus restriction. A history of trauma and CT imaging would confirm the diagnosis. Thyroid orbitopathy shows characteristic bilateral involvement with proptosis, lid retraction, and laboratory and clinical features of thyroid disease. Orbital inflammatory disease and orbital cellulitis present with a tender inflamed globe. Others have their own characteristic history and findings. Causes of acquired superior rectus weakness are a partial third nerve palsy, progressive external ophthalmoplegia. This involves multiple muscles and is bilateral. Myasthenia gravis symptoms and signs worsen later in the day and can be confirmed by the hydrophonium test, anticholinesterase antibodies, and electromyography. Others like labyrinthine disorders and cerebellar tumors have their own unique findings. The non-surgical management of monocular reservation deficiency consists of correction of the refractive error and amblyopia therapy if present. The indications for surgical treatment are a significant vertical deviation in primary gaze. The correction of this will also increase the field of binocular vision. Significant abnormal head posture, strabismic amblyopia, and diplopia in primary gaze. These are the various techniques in use today. There is no consensus on the exact procedure, which is ideal, as there are various etiologies. The NAPS procedure is the standard surgical procedure followed today in monocular elevation deficiency. This is a diagrammatic representation of NAPS procedure. In brief, a conjunctival incision is made over the medial and lateral rectus muscles. The muscles are freed from their attachments and then transposed by sutures, which are placed across the corners of the insertion of the superior rectus. In contrast to the original NAPS, wherein the whole tendons are transposed, only the superior halves of the horizontal muscles are transposed to the superior rectus insertion in the modified NAP procedure. After performing the NAPS procedure, the effect can be augmented by placing a non-absorbable suture 8 mm posterior to the insertion of the superior rectus, thereby fixing 25% of the belly of each transposed muscle adjacent to the superior rectus. The results of NAP surgery are variable, with a tendency for greater correction occurring over time. Now let's see what the modified Nishida's technique is. The technique was originally described for lateral rectus palsy, wherein the lateral muscle belly margins of the vertical recti were sutured onto the superotemporal or inferotemporal sclera to aid in abduction. This was a no-stitch, no-tenotomy technique, the advantages being a reversible procedure and no risk of anterior segment ischemia. Using the same principle, Murthy and Pappuru first performed the surgery for monocular elevation deficiency by taking a bite of the horizontal muscles through the superior one-third 10 mm behind their incision. The second bite was taken through the sclera 12 mm behind the limbus in the superotemporal and superonasal quadrants, midway between the superior rectus and horizontal rectus muscles. This suture bite transposes the horizontal rectus fossae superiorly. They obtained a correction of 30 prism diopters without and 40 prism diopters with inferior rectus recession. A good result with this technique was later obtained by another researcher. This may become one of the standard surgical treatments in the future. A useful algorithm for consideration in surgical treatment of monocular elevation deficiency. The force reduction test is the preliminary procedure to decide on the further course of action. If the force reduction is positive, then a small degree of hypotropia can be managed by inferior rectus recession alone. Whereas in a slightly larger degree of hyperopia, the inferior rectus recession needs to be combined with a modified NAPS or a superior rectus resection. On the other hand, if the force reduction is negative, a superior rectus resection may be performed in a mild hypotropia if there is some superior rectus action. If absent, then an inferior rectus recession with modified NAPS is performed. A slightly larger hypotropia requires an inferior rectus recession with a modified NAPS. In higher degrees of hypotropia, the surgical treatment is the same regardless of the results of the force reduction. An inferior rectus recession with the original NAPS, that is full tendon transfer, is used in moderate hypotropia, and with an augmented NAPS, that is NAPS procedure combined with posterior fixation sutures on the horizontal recti, in severe hypotropia. Alternately, a modified Nishida's procedure may be tried along with an inferior rectus recession. The advantage of the modified Nishida's procedure is that it can be performed in the same sitting as the inferior rectus recession, as there is no risk for anterior segment ischemia. Following the surgical correction of hypotropia and improvement in Bell's phenomenon, associated ptosis and or Marcus Gunn phenomenon can be addressed. The surgical procedures for acquired monocular elevation deficiency are essentially the same. However, they should be undertaken after all investigations and after waiting for at least 6 months to allow for recovery. So that's it for today. If you like what you saw, subscribe to my channel and hit the bell icon to never miss an update from AP's Ophthalmology Pulse. You may watch my other videos by clicking on the thumbnails. Please leave a note in the comment section if you wish for any particular topic to be covered in future. Look forward to regular updates. Thank you for watching.